Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Great to have you with us on the show today. Brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. High School Football Roundtable is today, the playoff edition. And also today, Bob Nightingale of USA Today on the World Series, which ended last night in seven with the Astros winning their first ever championship, fulfilling the prophecy of Sports Illustrated of June 30th, 2014, when they said Houston Astros, 2017 world champions, with, ironically, George Springer on the cover. How about that? The guy that ended up being the MVP. And now we get to the playoffs in high school football. My brother with picks today, sitting in first place, with Sean sitting in second.
Yeah, but you closed the gap. Look at you. I told you, one of these weeks you were going to clear the decks 6-0, like I did a few weeks back and your brother did. I think he did last week. So you have racked up a 6-0, so you have closed the back. You have closed the gap. I'm only one back, and you are only two back. Getting a little snug.
Even blind squirrels find acorns once in a while. All right, so
that's right.
that's my mantra. I'm going to live with it. So that's what we are on the show today. It's a pretty good lineup today. I assume all of our high school announcers are going, or did one back out?
We're going to go at least two out of three. 667 batting average gets you into the Hall of Fame, but so he texted me this morning. I'm leaving the house after 7 o'clock to get down here because I was helping out on the mark this morning. And Sue sends me a text. It's going to be a little tight. I have a 2:30 meeting. And I'm like... The first thing I thought was, you said, you know, there's, you know, you only have 10 of these. You only have, well, now you have 11 of these. But
well,
I said, you can go out and call me from the parking lot.
Jamie's meetings take a long time because they're negotiating. How long does it take for somebody to tell him no? It can't be that long a meeting.
Just did, right there. Didn't take long at all.
Jamie, great to see you. Suit. So we don't know if we have him today or not.
I hope we do. They'll probably come barnstorming in with like 90 seconds to go or something. Greg's used to that. I mean, he's in there on the other side of the glass from where I'm at. He's in deep thought, giving you the complete Green Dragons breakdown, and then all of a sudden, like a banshee, right through the door, going through a dog leg left to his chair is the one and only. But Greg has this uncanny ability now to tune that out. Doesn't faze him one bit.
Well, it just means he's joining the rest of us.
Right. You're one of us, Greg.
Now you know how we feel.
He knows.
You know when I really perfected it? You should have seen Carburation Day at Indianapolis. I physically here, mentally shut down. The guy, I can see Greg's over there laughing now.
Oh, he is. That was a great day back in May of 2012.
Unbelievable. It reminded me of Bobby Rahal. Like, we're shutting it down here. uh, I'm telling you right now, you have not lived until you've seen biathlon. All right. Okay, skiing and shooting. Got it. Want to impress me? Bring back food. All right. That is the original intent of it, I believe. Oh. Now, see, now Greg's over there getting notes ready.
He is.
He's got every angle covered.
Yep.
Right. Zach will be on. He'll have every angle covered.
Yep. Just got in touch with him about an hour or so ago. Yep. He's ready.
And then we'll get this 5 to 10 minute generic speech, which in the end will be like the waiter that runs around the restaurant and looks really busy. And then you realize that nobody got any food. Stop laughing, Wetzel.
Yeah, he is. Now, Pat Ryan, Zach, and I, we were kind of going through a little four-way text conversation last night in regards to Logan Leiby, kind of breaking down. He's got a shot at 10,000 career yards. So we're kind of maybe guesstimating, kind of, you know, getting the dartboard out just to figure out, hey, he could do that in X number of games. So we'll just have to wait and see if that happens. But, of course, the team prize is where it's at and what they're dialed in to do. So, but first up's Jersey Shore tomorrow night.
Well, I'm going to be interested to see emotionally from Zach where they are because, you know, look, a lot of collateral emotionally was invested in the Southern Columbia game.
I'm glad you brought Southern Columbia up just for the fact we're probably not going to talk about them in the roundtable in the next half hour. But we did catch word late last week in the Southern Columbia Seawolves Grove game that Julian Fleming got hurt. So there is a shot he may not play tomorrow night. I don't think that's going to put the Tigers behind the eight ball. It'll give him an extra week of rest. But I thought that was quite interesting. Julian Fleming was he doesn't get a lot of praise about what he does on the other side of the ball. And his assignment last week was to cover Jared Inch. Well, after Fleming got hurt, Inch actually took off and he was able to get pretty close to 100 yards receiving. That happened late in the game after Fleming left. But you hear a lot about what he can do when he has the ball, but when he's defending, he doesn't get enough credit.
Well, Lewisburg's going to play at Loyal Sock.
Mm-hmm.
Jersey Shore is going to play at Salins Grove. And Athens is at Chickalamy. I can't begin to tell you, on behalf of everybody in the station, how happy we are Chickalamy isn't home. Because if we had to listen to the griping about trying to get to Athens. I can't believe it.
Well, Kevin joined me on game night last week, and after we went to a commercial break, after I turned the microphone off, guess what the first thing he said?
Thank goodness the game's at home.
Yes.
Because, I mean, he would have gotten a hotel. Stayed overnight on Thursday.
Well, I hear it's beautiful in Athens. Very picturesque, very scenic.
That's where Cale Sanderson won his Olympic gold medal.
That's right.
Oh, wait, wrong Athens. Yeah. We'll come back with more in a moment.
And ironically enough, it's Penn State Wrestling Media Day today. So
yes, it is.
Sir.
Yes, indeed. They go for what? I don't know. What are they going for? The eighth out of what will probably be the 15 or 20 national championships he's going to win.
What a wonderful predicament. We're now losing track of the number. Isn't that amazing? And to him, he's just so even keel. I mean, you know him very much, and he just doesn't think about stuff like that.
2 weeks ago, he and I sat down, and there was an interview I had to do. It's a feature we're doing on Zane Rutherford.
Now that'll be on the Penn State football story next week, correct?
We believe it's next week.
Okay.
There's one other that we're doing on concussion protocol, and we're trying to see which week. But right now Zane's scheduled for next week.
So just watch for the Roar segment, correct?
Right.
Yep.
Right. So then I'm sitting there and Kale and I are just chit chatting, you know, just waiting. They're setting up for the whole thing. Laughing about a couple things. And there was some event coming up, which I have emceed before, and he's been a part of before. And he says, hey, you're doing that thing Wednesday night, right? And I said, no, I can't. I got to go to New York. He goes, can I go with you? He looks at me. He says, geez, Steve, you get all the luck. He just has this dry sense of humor. He cracks me up. I love talking to the guy. Now, I want to point out that under the category of incredible dry sense of humor, tonight's coach guest will be Russ Rose on the show this evening. So,
well, his ladies picked up another great win.
Yeah, they won last night at Michigan State. Mm-hmm. They've got Rutgers this weekend. So we got that coming up. So Russ will be on the first part of the show tonight before James gets there. But ah, yes. Russ. Ah, that is tonight. But Kale, really intelligent, great approach, really an outstanding coach to go with the fact he was an outstanding wrestler. But again, he's a no-ego guy who's just got a really great sense of humor. And like, and he and I can kid around a little bit. Now, you know where the broadcast center is, right?
Absolutely.
So I walk, I don't know, this is 6 months ago or whatever. I walked into rec hall for something, and I go by Kale. He goes, hey, Steve, how you doing? I says, good, Kale, how you doing? He says, here to see your broadcast center? I said, no. I said, everybody told me you were taking good care of it. Well, you know, I mean, that's, you know, what the heck?
Right.
You know, the one thing that does get lost a little bit when people look at someone of that stature, or of Joe Paterno, or a James Franklin, or a Russ Rose, you know what they end up forgetting about them? They're people. So you can kid around with them. You can have fun with them. A little sense of humor, whatever. They can jab you. You can jab back just a little bit, and it's all fun because you like each other. They're people, too. All right? And believe me, Kale, I mean, you wouldn't know he'd won a single thing in the course of his lifetime. Just the way he is. Russ, the same way. You go into Russ's office, you know what you don't see in Russ's office?
Any trophies or plaques or that kind of thing.
No, anything about him. Hmm. Right, there are trophies and plaques in there, but the trophies are national champion, All-American. Yeah, it's all about the team. There's nothing except for the picture of Lori and the boys. There's nothing personal in there. So, and I've, you know, I think it was September, he and I went in there and sat in there for about a half hour one day. Just chewing the fat. And I can tell you, no, in certain terms, a lot of people would have loved to have been a fly in the wall listening to us chew the fat that day about solving all the world's problems. Oh. I mean, he and I have known each other for 38 years. I mean, we've known each other for 38 years. And then, maybe he'll admit that, you know, maybe that's one of his problems. He's known me for 38 years. I mean, that's, you know. So, all right, we'll take a break. We'll come back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you, the other guy's way or the SMC way. The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years.
Great broadcast. Really is. Bucknell, lucky to have them. As you know, I have a lot of respect for Doug. Greg Wetzel is already in the studio preparing himself for the segment. Zach Schauer is already preparing his segment. Any word yet on Dick Hort's partner?
Nada. Zip.
Well, that'll be the result of his meeting, but have you heard from him?
Right. I did check a half an hour ago before we crank things up, and yeah, he was nowhere to be found. Maybe he was en route back to Blue Hill Studios.
Yeah. You did get the first part of Gabe Kapler's press conference today.
I did, yes. We can run that now if you want.
Yeah, let's do that. Let's hear what the new manager of the Phillies had to say.
I think about this franchise, and I can't help but think about a history of excellence and a history of winning. And that immediately makes me think about some of the people that I watched growing up. Mike Schmidt comes to mind for me. Certainly Larry Boa and his ferocious style of play. And without question, just thinking through Charlie Manuel and his contributions to this organization and this city make me very proud to be even mentioned to be a contributor like those guys were. I think about some of the guys that followed them, that I played against. And the guys that come to mind for me are Ryan Howard and Jimmy Rollins and Chase Utley. And I was lucky enough to get to know Chase a little bit in Los Angeles. And I saw him prepare in the clubhouse. And it was unbelievable how much intent and how much intensity that he prepared for the game with. And during the game, how much effort he put in. He led by example. And that's how we're going to play baseball with the Philadelphia Phillies going forward. We're going to play with that same level of intent and that same level of intensity that Chase played with. We're going to make razor-sharp turns around the bases. When the ball enters the hitting zone, we're going to be in powerful and athletic positions. Before the game begins, we are going to prepare, so that we've thought through everything and we make strong, well-thought-out decisions. We are going to hunt for value at the margins. We're not going to leave any stone unturned to find our competitive advantages. We're going to think traditionally, and we're going to think progressively. We're going to mold those two things together. And all of this is in an effort to bring that effing trophy back to John Middleton. Ultimately, that's why we're doing everything that we do, because we care deeply about winning, and we are ultra competitive.
Well, he certainly hit all the points that every Philly fan was aching to hear. I mean, there's not anything in there that a Phillies fan didn't want to hear, was there? I mean, did he mention every great? I mean, he mentioned everybody except Johnny Callison. Next half hour, our roundtable. The announcers who really care about their teams will be joining us. Stop laughing as we continue on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Key Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Bob Nightingale, USA Today in the next half hour. Pick's final half hour. Time now for our high school roundtable. I'm going to assume we still have just two out of three.
Yep.
Well, fortunately for us, it happens to be the Lewisburg and Selinsgrove Grove games. We'll save Shikellamy to the end because obviously we're going to have to buy some time. So the company savior can get on board with us. So Lewisburg's going to play at Loyal Sock. Greg Wetzel joins us as always. Greg, welcome. It's great to have you with us, my friend.
Great to be here.
All right. So let's... it's a question I've asked you before, but now at playoff time, I'll re-ask it. You want to be playing your best football entering a playoff, as you know. Mm-hmm. And you know better than anybody. Right. Is Lewisburg or not?
I think right now they are playing their best football that they've played all year. Their offensive line has finally settled in. They seem to know the scheme that they want to play. And last week they ran for over 350 yards in the game against Mifflinburg. So they feel really good about themselves. Their freshman running back is much more confident with his cuts right now. And their quarterback, Nick Shedleski, only a sophomore, but he started as a freshman. So he's 20 games into his career as a varsity player, and he is really taking charge of the team right now. You know, we've had a lot of injuries. He's making sure guys are lined up in the proper position, that people know what the play is. He's really taking charge of the game out there in the field. So, yes, I think they are playing their best game right now.
Greg, you mentioned the injuries. Have they been able to get some guys back, or is it just still the same?
They're getting Dylan Farinato back this week, which will be a huge help offensively. I don't know if he's going to play defense or not. They got Andrew Ramirez back this year, this week also. So that helps their wide receiving core. But again, they're still thin in the secondary. Oh, I'm sorry. And they also got Andrew Shedleski back at linebacker, mm-hmm. which really is a big help there.
Yeah. All right. Now, along the way, they've had to play a lot of players in place of some of these guys. Do you see a long-term benefit because they'll enter next season with some experience?
Oh, for sure. And, for instance, Zach Bettle played last week, started a defensive back, made the first three tackles of the game for Lewisburg. Last year, he was a soccer player. He also plays in the band, so he gets no halftime speech, so to speak. You know, he's out with the band. But he played a heck of a game last week against Mifflinburg's best receiver. He did an outstanding job. Cameron Schreffler is another one. He wasn't going to play a lot of football this year, but because of injuries, he got into the game. He's playing both offensively and defensively. He's a wide receiver and defensive back. Played a really nice game offensively, blocking downfield, and he made a really nice catch, about a 27-yard catch at a crucial time in the game last week. So it's going to pay dividends down the road for Lewisburg.
Greg, give me a thumbnail of Loyal Sock and that where a couple of the things that you'll be watching for that you think are the swing points.
They are maybe the most athletic team that Lewisburg's played all year. They have a quarterback who goes 6'3", 205 pounds. He has thrown for close to 2,000 yards this year. Their running attack, they've almost rushed for 2,000 yards this year. They have a receiver who is a real good receiver. He's has 46 receptions for 850 yards and 12 touchdowns. So offensively, I think what we need to see is how Lewisburg deals with their athleticism. Because they're about as big as Lewisburg is. When they go across the line, they probably average about 230, 235 across the line offensively. But their offensive linemen really have good feet, good movement. They're pulling a lot on all the plays. And so how Lewisburg handles that, I think, is going to be a real key to the game.
Greg, absolute pleasure. Good luck with this coming up on 100.9 The Valley tomorrow night.
Thank you so much.
All right, that'll be 7 o'clock. 6:30 will be the airtime as Lewisburg plays at Loyal Sock. Sealands Grove at home. They get Jersey Shore. Zach Showers joins us. Zach, welcome back. Great to have you with us.
Hey, thanks for having me again.
All right, Zach. Southern Columbia, a lot of emotional capital was expended for a game like that. Because let's face it, you know, you got some brand names there. When you don't win it, how do you think they came out of it emotionally?
You know what? I think they came out okay. I think this team, with this pretty senior-laden team and just good leadership at the top, I think this was a game that they wanted and they put a lot of effort into. But it was ultimately they knew that however we come out of this game, as long as we're healthy, as long as hopefully we got a little bit better, the goal ultimately is to win a district championship and get to some state playoff games this year. So overall, I think if it was a younger team, we would be a bit more concerned about where they are mentally. But overall, I think when that game was over, this team pretty much flipped the switch and said, you know what, let's go take on Jersey Shore and put ourselves in good position to get back to the state playoffs.
I ask Greg this, and I'll ask you this, Zach. You want to be playing your best football going into a playoff. In what you've watched, I don't mean just last Friday night, but in the last 3 weeks with this team, do you feel like Sealands Grove starting to round into shape and play its best football?
Yeah, I do. And there's a couple different factors for that. Obviously, facing Southern, they're going to show a lot. But defensively, this team has just been so stout since the loss against Shikellamy in week four. They've been really shut down on defense, whether that's been the run game, whether that's been the passing game. You have two seniors on the defensive line that have been getting pressure in the backfield, and Tony Dressler and Adam Ritter. And then you have five linebackers led by Clayton Cheesley, senior in the middle, who has over 20 tackles for a loss on the season, and a back-end secondary that's been playing really well. And overall, last week, you look at Julian Fleming, who everybody knows about, and he had 11 catches for 150 yards, which sounds like a lot, but overall, they tackled well, they kept everything in front of them, and they only gave up one big play. Another factor they've gotten better has just been the offensive line. There's been a little bit more balance between the running game and passing game, in a couple games they've had to use that running game when the passing game wasn't clicking. So overall, rounding into shape. Another factor, senior Ricky Cope, who's a wide receiver, he played the first two games and went out with an injury, came back last week, didn't come in till the second quarter, and right away on probably a second or third snap, caught an 84-yard touchdown, and just in three games already has almost 400 yards receiving. So to add another weapon into Logan Libby's passing game is big moving forward. And actually, Cope hasn't played the last three times against Jersey Shore, so it's someone that they're going to have to prepare for on film that they haven't the past couple times.
Zach, we know over the years Kevin Hurt, for example, has mocked Jersey Shore openly on the air. It's just been one of those things, Zach. Sean, you'll back me up on this. And Jersey Shore has been really good year after year after year. Now, obviously, having his picture up in the locker room probably has been a motivator. But when you look at Jersey Shore, what is this product? I mean, they've been really good the last few years. What are some of the keys in this matchup? Because Jersey Shore certainly is going to bring a lot to the table.
Yeah, they are. And honestly, Jersey Shore doesn't do much different than what they've done in the past 4 years. Since Tom Gravish is taking over, they've been a physical team. They like to run the football. Last year, they threw the ball around a little bit more with now senior Elijah Shimori. He has a little yet less passing yardage, but still has 1,500 yards. And really, it all starts with their line and their running back, Kyle Toome. He's carried the ball 275 times on the season, which comes out to about 27 times per game. And when he's rolled, their team has seemed to roll. And two of their losses against Belfont in week one and against Sealands Grove in week six, he's been held for under 100 yards. So the big thing is just shutting him down and also stopping their big plays. They have a wide receiver, Hunter France, who has 800 yards receiving on just 33 catches. but almost half of those, over half of those yards has come in three games. So it's going to be a lot of trying to shut down their running game and not allowing big plays. Defensively, they come out in either a 5-2, a 6-2, and they really don't change much from play to play. It's a lot of, we're going to send six or seven guys and try to create the big play defensively. So the first meeting, Joe Kahn, the running back, went for 175 yards against them, and we expected most of the big plays to come in the passing game. I think tomorrow night you're going to see need to see a little bit more balance. The coaching staff last game felt that there's a lot of plays open in the passing game, and it just so happened that the running game was what began working after a few series. So being able to withstand that pressure, Southern did a lot of the same thing last week. So there's going to be a lot of pressure on the O-line to pick up those blitzes and what they're throwing at it. But if the O-line's there, there are a lot of plays to be made all over the field for the Salins Grove offense.
Eagle 107 tomorrow night. Zach, always a pleasure. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much. Have a good one.
On News Radio 1070 WKOK, it's going to be Shikellamy hosting Athens. And joining us on the road, pulled over to the side after having another emotional Save the Company meeting, is Kevin Herr.
Thank you, Stephen. Great to be with you.
How did it go, by the way?
Very well. Thank you for asking.
Sean, that tells us nothing.
I don't know. It sounded a little better than I thought it'd get.
Yeah, very, very well. We're all is good. All is good in the digital world.
Okay. Well, then don't forget, Shikellamy will be at home at Athens tomorrow night. Kev, thanks.
Great. It's a pleasure to be on the show. Thanks.
All right. They've got a running back, and he's pretty darn good. So that gets to the Shikellamy run defense. How well has it played this year?
Well, it's a Shikellamy run defense that's giving up about 4 yards of play on the ground. And that is going to be something that is going to turn into almost an automatic first down for Zach Jay. This is a young man who's averaging 8 yards a carry, over 2,000 yards already this year. As a matter of fact, the rushing game for Athens is basically Zach, 100%. Of the 2,900 yards, he has about 2,100 of them. But the thing you have to watch out, if you sold out on the run, now you got to watch out on young Caden Rude, the junior quarterback. He is very elusive, and he makes plays happen. If he gets out on the edge, he can actually make things happen. Not necessarily in the running game, but he's going to actually make it happen in the passing game. He's thrown 6 touchdowns. It's not really one of those passing attacks that's going to get you beat deep downfield, but it is going to move the chains. And when they haven't been able to run the ball successfully with Janie, they've been able to throw the ball for just enough to get first downs and keep the clock running. And that's how Athens' offense is set up to go.
Now let's talk about Shikellamy. I've asked the other two this. I'll ask you this. You want to be playing your best football going into a playoff. Are they?
Yeah, I think they are. I think they have in the last 3 weeks. The Loyalsock game, to me, was the turning point. They had played maybe 2-3 quarters of really good football and then 1 quarter that maybe wasn't so good in a few games or maybe was a little flat. The Loyalsock game really showed a lot about this team and a lot about the senior leadership. And we talked about this last week. There was not a downed head on the sidelines. And, you know, in high school football, emotions run high. And those seniors had every one of those younger players believing that they could get back in the game down 2 scores. And they were able to do it not once, but twice. And I think that's going to go a long way here in the playoffs. And I think that's done a number of things for the play of football going in here into the playoff run too. Last week they had a chance, they had a situation where they could have looked past Milton really easily, cruised into the playoffs and been okay, well maybe we didn't get the top over one number one seed, but they not only handled the game very well, they put the game away early. And I think that was the key point. They did not hang around, let Milton hang around. They went after him, they put the game away early, and by halftime it was virtually over.
Shikellamy advances if?
Shikellamy advances if they can keep Janie under 5 yards a carry. And that is going to be a big if. I think you're going to see them sell out on the run and say, beat us throwing the football. They run a 4-4, and right now the key is the linebackers. They've been playing very, very well. You have Josh Krieger, who has two interceptions this year, one for a touchdown. But I think the biggest part of the biggest stat that somewhat gets overlooked is his 15 tackles for a loss. He's been in the backfield more than any of the other linebackers. Gabe Tilford, the outside linebacker, leads all tackles, just under 100. He's forced four fumbles this year, recovered three, and he has five interceptions, leading the team with three defensive touchdowns. Linebackers are the key defensively. The first question you ask, what does Shikomi's defense have to do? The linebackers need to stuff the run.
Well, thanks for saving us all today the way you did, and thanks for the update and the broadcast tomorrow.
It's a pleasure. It's one of those things that this is one of the tough teams you don't know a whole lot about, Steve, but at 8-2, you have to think that they have to have something going right up there in Athens.
Well, I know you're just happy the game's at home.
Yes, I am, more than you know, and I know a lot of fans are right there with me. It's a very short 5-minute trip down the hill to Shikellamy Stadium, and boy, it'd be nice to have a couple of games there before the season's over yet.
As always, you are a man of the people.
Hey, Steve, have a great call on Saturday. Thanks, bud.
Thanks, appreciate it. All right, Kevin Herr. Well, Sean, well, we got a double barrel there. We feel like now we've had the company savior on.
Breathe a sigh of relief. We're good.
That's okay. When he gets back, we'll actually find out what happened. All right. At 7 o'clock tomorrow night, 6:30 the airtime, here on News Radio 1070 WKOK. It's playoff time. No more speculation about playoffs. Now you're bracketed. We'll come back with more in a moment. Bob Nightingale, USA Today, next half hour here on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Playoff time in high school football. We've got plenty of it for you tomorrow. On 100.9 The Valley, it's Lewisburg playing at Loyal Sox. 7 o'clock the kickoff, 6:30 the airtime. Meanwhile, Jersey Shore at Sealands Grove on Eagle 107, 7 o'clock the kickoff, 6 o'clock the airtime. Sean on after the game with the area's best postgame show. Complete coverage, interviews, highlights, and so forth. Sean has it all for you on Eagle 107 after the game. And here on News Radio 1070 WKOK, Shikellamy at home to take on Athens. 7 o'clock the kickoff, 6:30 the airtime with Kevin and the coach, Dick Hort. Bob Nightingale next half hour, talk about the World Series. Picks in the final half hour. Penn State at Michigan State Saturday in East Lansing. Kickoff set for noon. We're on beginning at 10:30. And a lot of people say, oh, noon kickoff. You're on the road. I'm like, yeah, I'm all for it. Noon kickoff, all for it. I have no idea what the Saturday night game is. Do you? What it is this week? I didn't see.
I know it's not Bedlam. That's 4 o'clock. Right. Let's see. It may have been one of the. Let's see. Because we're only picking two college. Or wait, we're picking four college, two pro. Let me scroll back here and check the list.
I mean, Navy and Temple's tonight. Northern Illinois and Toledo's tonight.
Stanford, Washington State. Obviously, that'll be Saturday night.
Yeah, it's late. Yeah,
late.
Because I mean, I'll be back in time for the 7:30 game. Whatever that is, Clemson, Virginia Tech.
That could be.
That probably is it.
Sounds about right.
Yeah. Not bad. All right. Or I could watch the MLS Cup. No, Clemson, Virginia Tech seems like a good option. Yeah.
You're listening to News Radio 1070 WKOK Sunbury. You can hear us anywhere in the world with the Sunbury Broadcasting Corporation app.